I have long advocated and promoted the fact that an education that does not include art is incomplete. Not just because art is fun or creative or helps children express themselves, but that it is necessary for student success. A 2014 study by Plus One shows that exploring art and making art both help the brain make more neural connections, but that making art showed greater cognitive gains. Evidence from the National Assembly of State Arts Agencies and the AEP support the fact that art students are more successful than their non-art involved peers by a significant margin. Students who take art succeed at higher rates than their peers on tests like the SAT, on average by 100 points. My own students in 2013 scored 150 points higher on average than their peers, and they were 50% more likely to pass the HESPA exam. Art teachers know that when we grid, measure, and draw, we use geometry. When we make sculptures, we use engineering. When we mix colors, we reveal information about physics. When we create illustrations for stories, we learn about literature. When we review the styles of art from Da Vinci to Banksy, we teach history. When we write about art, we strengthen these skills. When we create works of art, we solve complex visual problems in creative ways. A big portion of the fight is not just educating our students, which really should be everything, but also to educate our colleagues, administration, and community in terms they understand, terms used outside our subject. Concrete, verifiable information they can hang their hat on and become our advocates. As a community of creative persons, it can be hard for us to break out and be proactive when we are so overwhelmed already. When we talk to outsiders about how creative, fun, and full of self-expression our subject is, those same outsiders hear frivolous. But if instead we tell them that art is about problem-solving, divergent thinking processes, making connections within core subjects like math, science, literature, and that our students score significantly higher on important assessments like the SAT, they get it. Early Childhood News posted a great article by Carolyn Tomlin. In it, we can see the concrete benefits of art education explained beautifully. Art promotes creativity. Art builds self-confidence. Art promotes group and individual learning. Art teaches task analysis, like what should we do first? What comes next? What is the last thing we will do to complete this project? And can you think of a simpler way to perform this task? For art to survive and thrive in our public schools, it must do two important things. These are things we have always done, but may have had trouble articulating. One, art must connect to the child's life experience or point of view. Otherwise, it's not expressive and therefore not art. Two, projects must be connected to core content information to reinforce learning and understanding. We have no problem with the first. Connecting to the child's interest is how the work stays relevant to its maker and sustains interest. It is what makes art, art. I would argue that follow-along cookie-cutter lessons undermine this and diminish the importance of art education to a testing-focused, results-oriented school environment. When we do lessons that connect students' interests and content in such a way that originality is guaranteed, students learn and succeed at much higher rates. Take these unique birds, for instance. We learned about the different kinds of birds and how their form and function differ, like chickens and eagles or storks. We then wrote about our own personal interests and how we could create bird forms to mimic this idea, form tied to function. An athletic student might want large legs or wings to show off their skills. A quiet student might make a beak smaller. A show-off might use bright colors, while a shy student might tend to use color sparingly. All these factors lead to projects with depth. We need to understand that for better or worse, schools must focus on testing because their funding depends on it. We can either argue about the evils of testing and bemoan the loss of art for art's sake, or recognize that this change is not a fad, but the reality we must live in. I do not foresee the pendulum swinging in the other direction. As the corporatization of America continues, success will be more carefully measured and tested, and those that fail to meet the standards that have been set will lose their standing and funding. This is why the second part, connecting to core, is so important. Keep in mind, we already do. I should add that when I speak about core content, I am not talking about Common Core, By core content, I mean the normally tested subjects of language, math, and science. And, as I said before, many already do connect to the core content. So how do we slip in a little of that core content? We could take out a prism when we're talking about color. Have students write about their ideas and post-write about their results. Take a few minutes to review vocabulary from our elements and principles. Do oral and written critiques or a formal research paper. Speak about and explore the history of Leonardo da Vinci or Van Gogh when the lesson's focus turns in that direction. Most of us already do these things, and those that don't can incorporate them very easily. It may mean projects take a bit longer or you'll do fewer throughout the year, but the added depth, student success, and longevity of your department will be worth it. So once you're doing all the right things, how do you get people to notice? Number one, find out through your guidance department how your students are doing on testing as compared to the non-art population. In some cases, every student takes art, but in others, art is an elective. I found that my own students scored about 155 points higher than the school average on the SAT, and 50% were less likely to fail the HESPA exam. This kind of information should be shared with your administration, community, and others to understand the impact art can have. Number two, do at least one project a year that will connect to your local community in some beneficial way. It is the local community that votes for or against budgets and either supports or does not understand your program. These people will turn in and become your advocates, partnering with local food bank, community services, or retirement community are some easy, low-hanging fruit you can pick. Three, seek out opportunities for press at least once a year. Consider the projects you do, particularly if you do a project that does connect to your community or one where the lower grades work with higher grades. I sometimes partner with an elementary school. I take their elementary drawings, and our high school students professionally color in their work. The results are often stunning, and the local press will love to publish an article on it. Create a teaching display of student work for number four. We often display art in school, but to do so in a way that shows your colleagues and administration that you have a core-connected approach. Include vocabulary signs, pre-writing samples from students, as well as post-written critiques. Let it show off the amazing things that you do. 5. Don't let it slide when others use terms that diminish your department. I have a blog post about this, but terms like prep, resource, exploratory, enrichment, and specials diminish the importance of what we do. Push for an acronym like VPA, Visual and Performing Arts, or Humanities. When you let people call you less than you are, it erodes your own self-confidence. 6. Collaborate. Make connections with others in your school and community and online. Do at least one project a year with another department. I have sought out the biology department for her posters of biomes, and we did landscapes based on her resources, vocabulary, and created a wonderful display. She loved that I took the time to seek her out, make connections, and the administration was pleased with my results. This can be done with any subject taught in school and will have a lasting impact. As for online connections, the Facebook Art Teachers Forum has about 12,000 members or more and is a wealth of information and resources. It will take a while to become a member, but once approved, the group is well worth it. 7. Invite your administration in. When you are doing particularly connected or impressive projects, send fun invitations out to administrators to pop by. Waiting for them to stop in for the perfunctory observation is not enough. These are people that hold the purse strings to your budget and can be your greatest local advocates or headaches. Make the first move to be proactive. Develop these positive relationships from vice principals all the way to the superintendent and your board of education. They might not always come, but I truly believe your persistence may pay off. And 8. Exhibiting within your school is good, but also doing exhibitions in your community is better. Participate in your county, state, art exhibitions. Youth Art Month. NAEA opportunities. And if there are none, start one. I would also say that art teachers should also exhibit their personal work and seek out press for these occasions. It raises your own standing publicly and gives you some hands-on me time that is very valuable. If you would like to read more about this topic or explore a core-connected program like I use, please visit my website at artedguru.com. And for published resources, firehousepublications.com. Thank you.